Special welcome to everybody from the Living Open Source community. It's good to see that we have many people from Africa in today's session. I hope you are doing all right far away in Africa and everything is going well there. And I hope you can hear me all right. Let me just type a message in the chat for those people who cannot hear me. Because I do know that in some cases it happens that people have issues connecting to the session. Right, I would like to get started. The purpose of today's class is to teach you about running containers. The background of this class is Red Hat Certified System Administrator, or the RHCSA exam. You might be aware that recently Red Hat has announced that new content will be examined on the RHCSA exam. And yeah, this was a surprise to everybody. And being the author of a book as well as a video course, I felt that I need to do something, and that is why I offered this class. So your background, ideally you already know about Linux. I'm not going to explain about Red Hat Enterprise Linux here. I am going to explain how to run containers, and my mission is to cover the contents that will be on the new RHCSA exam. Even if you are not interested in preparing for the RHCSA exam, I think the content we are covering here today is relevant to everybody, because computers are kind of, containers are kind of the future in IT. Right, some housekeeping messages. First, I am going to mute everybody. That means that you can try to open your microphone. I won't hear you. My preferred way of communicating is the chat. So if you post a message into the chat, I will see your message. And if your message is a question, then I will answer your question as fast as I can. I try to make sessions like today's session a little bit interactive. Sometimes that's difficult, but we will just see how it is going. Should be all right. So at any time, if you have a question, feel free to post your question in the chat. This is a 3-hour session. I like to start on time. I like to finish on time. So 3 hours it is. And during the 3-hour session, we will be having 2 breaks in total. My breaks typically are 12 minutes. Oh, and for those who are interested, this is part 1 of an additional contents for RHCSA session. Part 2 will be offered next week on Thursday, and that is a 3-hour introduction to Bash shell scripting. All right, that is all that you need to know. There is one thing that you might be interested in knowing as well. If you want to follow along, then I would say make sure that you have a virtual machine that is running the latest version of CentOS. As for myself, I'm using CentOS 8.2. I would suggest that you are using CentOS 8.2, maybe Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8.2 as well. I am not going to support any other platforms because the contents in today's class is very specific to what Red Hat and the Red Hat family is doing regarding containerization. So let's have a look. I will start from the slides, and in order to make it possible for you to see what I'm doing, I'm sharing access to the slides right now. So the slide might have a surprising lesson number, lesson 27. That is because this is going to be a part of my RHCSA video course as well. Right. First, we need to talk about containers, and I'm going to tell you more about it. So what are containers? Well, containers, a container is a complete package to run an application, and the package contains all of the application dependencies. Containers are the replacement of running applications directly on top of a server platform. You can, of course, still run applications on top of a server platform, but running containers directly on top of a server does come with a couple of challenges. And that is why containers have become big. Containers have been around for a decade, approximately. Well, that's not the right way of saying it. Containers have become popular in the last decade. So 15 years ago, nobody was talking about containers. And the reason they have become popular is that a container is a complete package to run an application, and it has all of the application dependencies. It is basically the difference between installing an application on your computer that may be running Windows or installing an application on your smartphone. You know, in your smartphone, you go to the App Store, and from the App Store, you select the application that you want to run. And after selecting the application that you want to run, it is just there, and it does not need any additional configuration. And that is cool. Another benefit of containers is that they make it easy to run different versions of application dependencies side by side. Which means that if you have one container that requires Python 2 dot whatever and another that requires Python 3 dot whatever, you just build the dependency inside the container and they can run side by side on the same host operating system. Containers do run on top of a container engine, and this container engine is offered by the host operating system. And this host operating system typically is Linux. Now, let me be very clear about this. Linux is not the only platform where you can run containers, but containers are something that natively comes from a Linux environment. Containers are Linux, and containers are using functionality that is provided by the Linux kernel. And if other operating systems are offering containers as well, that is because they are putting a relatively heavy container engine on top of the operating system, or because they are offering a Linux simulation layer so that Linux kernel features can be presented to the containers. Now, containers do look a little bit like virtual machines. There are many differences, but probably the most significant difference is that the operating system kernel is not included in the container. It is offered by the host operating system. And that means that you can perfectly run an Ubuntu container on top of Red Hat. But if you run an Ubuntu container on top of Red Hat, you will see that the Ubuntu container is using the Red Hat kernel and not the Ubuntu kernel. And because the kernel is not included in all of the containers, that makes containers a lot more efficient than virtual machines. There's another difference. And the other difference is that the mission of the container typically is to run an application. The mission of a virtual machine is to provide an operating system platform in which you can run whatever you want to do. The mission of a container is to run an application, and that is what it's created for. Now, sometimes containers can be abused as something that looks like a virtual machine, but that is definitely not something that you should be doing. If you want to start a container, you need a container image. The container image is the thing that you are going to use to run your application. Compare your container image to a Linux Live CD. You boot from the Linux Live CD. It's a read-only image like the Linux Live CD, and it is giving you a complete operational environment. Now, if you want to store data in a container, because of the fact that the container comes from a read-only container image, it's not possible to store directly into the image, so something must be provided to store data anyway. So there must be some connection to the storage. We will explore how that is happening. So let's continue. Containers can also be seen as processes, which means that the purpose of a container is to run an isolated process. To do this, the container images are configured to run a standard application. And once that application is finished, the container is done. If you want to name that application in the smart way, you would call the application the entry point. Every container image should be configured with an entry point. This entry point is a default application. So you run your application. After running the application, the entry point is started, and once the entry point is done, then the container is done. And from that perspective, you can compare running a container with running an arbitrary command on Linux, like you type ls on Linux, for instance. What is the result? Ls produces its output, and then ls is done. And that is likewise in containers, typically. So remember that part, that where the application is finished, the container is done. Right, application containers are a type of containers that are used to run common applications. System containers are used as a foundation to build custom images, and they don't come with a standard application. Now, what exactly is the difference? Well, the difference is that the system container is pretty clear. It's not starting an application. The system container is a foundation that allows you to build your own container. And the purpose is that you are going to use your system container, for instance, in a Docker file. And once you have created your Docker file, it can run whatever application you want. The application container is what is used to run common applications. Let me name one or two examples. You may think about the Nginx application container. You may think about the MySQL application container. The purpose is you start the application container, and by starting the application container, you are in business and your application is running. Right. Before we continue, just quick repeating the intro, because I see that quite a few people have joined us since we started. Intro, very simple. The only thing that you need to know, I have disabled your microphones because I'm expecting a relatively big group, and I'm expecting audio quality not to be great for everybody. If you have any questions, feel free to ask your questions in the chat. And I do appreciate if every now and then you say hi or whatever, and give me a sign that you are still alive, because we are a nice group of 13 people right now from everywhere around the world, ranging all the way from Friesland to Zambia and many countries in between. And yeah, I do appreciate knowing that you are here, at least. So don't hesitate if you have any questions, because otherwise it's just like a recording course, and that is so boring. I am here, and I'm interested in knowing what you want to know, right? I might have to repeat this once more, because I'm still missing half of the number of people that I'm expecting for this class. So while waiting for that, let me continue. So container requirements, what do we need to run a container? Well, containers, as I was mentioning, containers are Linux, and they rely heavily on features that are provided by the Linux operating system. If you talk about that from a Red Hat perspective, there are three important features. Feature number one is namespaces. Namespaces offer the isolation between processes. Now, how should you see this? Well, compare it to networking. You may have come across networking, VLAN technology on a network. What is the idea in a VLAN? Well, the idea is that you have many network nodes that are connected to a switch, and you are going to tag the different ports on the switch to make sure that the switch thinks that they are in different isolated environments. That is what a namespace is all about. Namespace is about providing strict isolation between the different processes. And you will find namespaces in different areas. Some people say it's five areas. That is wrong. It started with one area, which is the mount namespace, where a directory basically is presented as the root of the entire file system. This is also known as chroot, but the number is still growing. Some of the most important namespaces are the process namespace, the mount namespace, the network namespace, and the user namespace. These namespaces are very important because it makes that the container is only seeing what the container should be seeing. And Nitin, welcome. Namaste Bharat. I think that's how you say welcome to India. Nice to have people from India in this class as well. Right. Containers typically run one application, and multiple applications can be connected in microservices. Containers is also a buzzword in microservices environments. And microservices is what you can define as different services running together to provide a solution. This course is not about microservices, because that would be the next level. This course is really strictly about containers, because that is what you need in order to get through your RHCSA level contents. Good. To manage containers at an enterprise level, orchestration is needed. So what is the orchestration all about? Well, the thing is that the container by default is running standalone on a standalone host. And nobody is watching the availability of your container. Nobody is taking care of the scalability of your container and much more. And that is why orchestration is required if you are going to run your important business applications on top of containers. And that is that thing that you may have heard of called Kubernetes. Kubernetes is a container orchestration platform, very powerful, very, very hot, and everybody needs to know about that as well. The reason that Red Hat has ensured us that container basic knowledge is a part of RHCSA at this point is because Red Hat has OpenShift. OpenShift is the orchestration platform that Red Hat is providing, and that makes sure that containers are used in a reliable way, and if a server goes down, that your workload is still there. OpenShift is something very interesting as well, and definitely I will be offering OpenShift classes within a couple of months. Right now I'm working on the development of that content, so stay tuned, I will be back and you will hear more about that. Just to give you an impression, if you want to run OpenShift, you need a minimum of 5 virtual machines. And if you really want to build a small OpenShift cluster, these 5 virtual machines need a total of 80, that is 80, not 18, just to be sure, 80 gigabytes of RAM. So it's kind of challenging running OpenShift on your laptop. But that's a different story. Let's not talk about that too much. We should be talking about containers on RHEL 8. Generically, different container solutions exist. So if you talk about solutions to run containers, the solution that really has become big is Docker. Docker is a solution that was launched in 2013, basically. That was the year of Docker. Suddenly they were there, and Docker has become kind of the standard in containerization. In the beginning, Docker was open source, and that was pretty cool, and everybody could be using Docker. And Docker had an amazing Docker registry. The Docker registry is like a repository where the open source community could provide different container images. And that is why everybody started using Docker. But Docker was also one of the Silicon Valley companies, and behind Docker there was a lot of money, and Docker Inc. wanted to make money, and that is why they started closing down some vital components. They wanted to earn money, and that wasn't doing very well. And that is just one of the reasons why Red Hat has been starting to offer something new. That has been starting in RHEL 8. In RHEL 8, Red Hat is offering a couple of new utilities to work with the containers. And these are Podman, Builder, and Scopio. Now, what is Podman? Podman is the core utility. That's the utility that you will find on your exam. It's the utility that you are going to use to manage containers and to manage container images as well. There is the Builder utility. The Builder utility, you can see that as a solution to build your own container images. Let's try to understand this. Containers are pretty common in environments where developers have created an application and the developer wants to run this application and wants to start offering the application. In the past, the developer needed to provide an installer, and in the past, the developer would tell their customers, hey, you need to install Windows Server, whatever. Nowadays, the developer is just delivering a container image. And that means that if you are that developer, you have created your own application, you want to distribute your application to your customers, you need to build an image. And that is what Builder is meant to do in a Red Hat environment. You may have heard of Dockerfile. Dockerfile is kind of the alternative in a pure Docker environment. Builder is how you should do it in a Red Hat environment. Podman is a replacement of the Docker command. It is what you run in Red Hat to work with containers. And then there is Scopio. Scopio is not a very common utility. You might not even come across, but it's also a utility that Red Hat started offering with the release of Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8. It's a utility to inspect, delete, copy, and sign images. Basically, it's the utility that is used to work with images in image registries. Now, if we are RHEL 8, in RHEL 8, Red Hat has dropped support for Docker. Before Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8, Red Hat was supporting Docker, and Docker was the default container stack. In Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8, Red Hat has announced, we stopped doing that, and we now come with our own set of utilities. Now, that sounds pretty bad, but in fact, it is not so very bad, and that is because of the Open Containers Initiative. Open Containers Initiative is a standardization body that makes sure that container solutions are highly compatible and interchangeable. And that means that in RHEL 8 you work with Podman, in RHEL 7 you work with Docker. The only difference is the name of the command in functionality-wise. Not so much has changed. So if you are dealing with ignorant users, and your ignorant users want an easy solution to work with these containers, well, then they can use Podman in the same way that they were using Docker before. Right. One thing that is pretty important in containers in RHEL 8 is what Red Hat calls the rootless container. The rootless container is something that is pretty cool. Because that means that a container in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8 can run without root privileges. So that means that ordinary users can run containers. And the fact that ordinary users can run containers without root privileges is one of the distinguishing features between Podman and Docker. Talk about Docker. In Docker, you needed root privileges to run a container. In Docker, you would accomplish that by making your user a member of the group Docker. In RHEL 8 on top of Podman, none of that is needed, and any user can run one of these rootless containers. Rootless containers is really something that is special, and also something that makes working with containers different in RHEL 8. Hey, there is one thing that I need to say. If you want to run your rootless, if you want to run your container with root privileges, that is possible. You can just do that using sudo in front of the name of the container. But the default is that the rootless container is using ordinary user privileges. I see that some people are trying to get in. I see some activity in the Zambia WhatsApp group. If anyone from Zambia is listening here, want to help the people in who are not in yet, please go ahead. But just want to make you aware that some people are trying to get in, and I just want to focus on teaching contents here. Right, let's continue talking about rootless containers. If containers need to run a process on a privileged port, they need to run with root privileges. Now, if you need to run a container with root privileges, then typically you would use sudo to start your container. So rootless containers run as a non-root user, and they do that because running containers as root is more more dangerous. So the idea of a rootless container is basically that users are starting to run their own applications. And there is no restriction that prevents a user from running their own application. The only requirement is that they are using a non-root, a non-privileged port. And you probably know that the TCP and UDP ports below 1024 are privileged. So for a rootless container, if you want to expose the container so that users can access it, you need a port above 1024. Right, let's talk a bit about scaling containers. So running containers in an enterprise environment requires a solution that offers additional features, and these additional features allow you to easily scale containers up and down. Now, what is this this scalability stuff? Well, this is all about making sure that, sufficient workload is offered. So how should you see that? Imagine that you have a web shop. You run your web shop as a container, and you want to make sure that in the busy days of the year you have sufficient capacity so that your users don't wait forever until they get a connection. You want multiple containers, and you want to put a load balancer in front of it. And that is what we mean with scalability. Another feature that can be needed in an enterprise environment is to ensure container availability. Availability in the sense that if the container goes down, that something will take care of starting the container again. And something else that is needed in corporate environments is developer workflow. Developer workflow in the sense that as a developer, you may be working on writing your source code. And if significant changes have been applied to your source code, the changes will automatically compile to a new running application. And all of that, the scalability, the availability, the developer workflow, all of that is offered by Red Hat OpenShift. Red Hat OpenShift is the Kubernetes distribution that Red Hat is offering. Again, we don't do OpenShift in this class, we do containers. So I guess that at this point, I am going to demonstrate how to run a container. But before I do that, do we have any questions? Let me give you at least a little bit of time to ask questions. And if you don't, that is okay as well. Then we will just continue. So what are we going to do now? I don't see any questions coming in. So I am going to continue. I'm going to share access to my virtual machine. So where is it? I think this is the one. You should be seeing my virtual machine right now. Login prompt. This is CentOS 8.2 virtual machine. If you have anything alike, that should work. No, just want to disable screensaver so that I don't have to type my password every time. Oh, was already disabled. That is good. And I want to change the display resolution to make it a little bit more visible. Everybody, could you please confirm that after changing the display resolution, you can still see all parts of the virtual machine window? I like having this working space, but if you are missing stuff on the edges, please let me know. Opening my terminal. Thank you for confirming, Hermano. And here is my terminal. And let me increase the font size just a little bit. And let me show you how to work with it. First, I am user student. Notice that my user student is a member of the group Wheel, which allows the student user to run commands using sudo elevate privileges. And the first thing that I'm going to do is sudo yum module install container tools. You probably are aware that in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8, there is this new thing. This new thing is called YUM modules. And a YUM module is basically a package of software. It's very close to a to the previously used groups. And by using, by installing the YUM module container tools, you get everything that you need to work with containers. And that means that I can start right now running a command like popman run minus d nginx. Let's do it without minus d first so that you understand what the minus d is for. So I'm running popman run nginx. What do we see? We see that it's trying to pull registry access.redhat.com, but requires terms acceptance. Then it's trying to pull registry.redhat.io, but it's complaining about authentication. We'll cover that later. Fortunately, by default, after installing the container tools, with everything that you try to do with your containers, it's going to look up the Docker registry. And in the Docker registry, it apparently has found nginx. Then we can see that it's copying blobs and configs. Now, what is this? Well, in a container, you are using a layered file system. The thing is that container images consist of different layers, and the different layers is because of efficiency. The efficiency is that many application container images need a base system images, so they are built on the base image, and instead of putting everything in a new image, the modification is applied on top of the base image, and every layer is downloaded as such. That makes it easier to manage changes. So when you use Docker, this is Popman. When you use Popman run to run a container, then you can see it is pulling these different image layers, and on top of the different image layers, it will run the container. Now, what do we see? We see basically right here, this is the container. This is the container that is running. So the container is keeping up my terminal, and I can't do anything with my terminal anymore. That's not so convenient. So let's add the option minus D, which formally stands for detached mode. Some people call it the daemon mode. That is wrong, but I like the idea of daemon mode because that is really what it is doing. It starts a container a little bit like daemon in the background. So we can see that Popman run is throwing an ID. That's the ID of the container, and at this point my container is available. Now, if I am going to use Popman PS, Popman PS allows me to verify the availability of this container. So what do we see? In Popman PS, we see the container ID. The container ID happens to be the first part of the long ID that we see here. We see the image that is being used. So the image is docker.io, which refers to the Docker registry slash library slash nginx. And then the image is tagged as latest. You can use image tags to provide some further identification for what you are doing in an image. And that allows you to refer to a specific version. If in your Popman commands you are not referring to any specific version, then you just get latest. Then we get the command that has been running, that's the nginx command, created and a status and ports. We don't see any ports here because I've not done anything to share port access. And we have names as well, a gifted Bartik. Now, what is this name? This name is just to make it easier for us humans to work with the containers. That's how you run a container, the easy way. Now, when we started the container, it was looking for registries. And we need to talk about these registries a little bit. So I'm using sudo vim in etc containers registries.conf. And there we see what is going to happen if you are using Popman to get access to whatever you want. The sections that are important are on the screen right now. first section is registries.search. Registries.search is what is used when you are looking for container images. So these are the registries that that Podman is looking in. So there's three of them. There's registry.access.redhat.com, registry.redhat.io, and there is docker.io. If we start with the last one, docker.io is a community registry. Community registry means that it is open to anybody. It doesn't require any privileges, and it is used as the last registry just to ensure that you have increased chances of being successful when you are trying to run your container. But the container images that are provided through docker.io have never been optimized for use in a Podman environment. Many of the container images that you will find here, for example, need root privileges to run. And that is why there is registry.access.redhat.com and registry.redhat.io. But the problem is that in order to get access to these registries, you need to provide login information. So if we get out of this configuration file, let me do that in a bit, then we can provide the login information to make sure that container images are fetched at the location where we need to fetch them. There is also registries.insecure. Registries.insecure is where you can put your own registries because you can easily create your own registries. And if your registries are not protected with TLS certificates, then you would typically put them in registries.insecure. Anything that is happening in here will not complain about the fact that it's receiving a self-signed certificate and for that reason is insecure. And registries.block is how you can block specific registries. Right, I want to show you Podman login because if you want access to the Red Hat registries, then you need to specify how to access. Can we find that information using -h? Well, -h is only giving us a localhost colon 5000. So I need to scroll up a little bit. Where we were trying to pull registry.redhat.io and where it was telling us, hey, registry.redhat.io needs additional authentication. So if you repeat the Podman login again, and we do that for registry.redhat.io, we can authenticate. Now, how do you authenticate on the Red Hat registry? Well, that's simple, by using your Red Hat account. And if you don't have a Red Hat account yet, then you open your browser. There we go. I will show you. And you go to developer.redhat.com. Red Hat is giving away free accounts. The only thing that you need to do, you need to sign up. So developer.redhat.com. There you go. Look for the information where you can create an account. And after creating your account, you can log in on this website. And that is pretty cool. And you can also use Podman login. And the same credentials as the credentials that you create here can be used to log in with Podman. So now that I am that I am logged in, I should be able to use commands like podman pull registry.access.redhat.com/ub8/ublatest. Let me first verify that everything is working all right. Yeah, this is working all right. I'm fetching the UB image here. UB is definitely something that you need to remember in terms of Red Hat because it's a universal base image. You know, many products are based on Red Hat Enterprise Linux 8, and UB, the universal base image, is the base for everything that Red Hat is offering that runs on top of a RHEL 8 image. Notice that I've now used Podman pull. Podman pull is just pulling the image. So if I'm using Podman images, then I can see the image that I've just pulled. which contains the UB8 image. And if I do Popman PS, then I can see the containers. Popman Pool doesn't start any container. It just fetches the image because it can be convenient to have your images locally available. I do know that we have one guy from Malawi, for example. I know what a pain decent internet access can be in a country like Malawi. So if you are there or somewhere on the countryside in Kenya or Zambia, you might want to pull your images before you are starting to work if you are not on a very reliable internet line. So that can absolutely be relevant. Right. Let's have a look at the next slide. I'm trying to swap a little bit between slides and demo, but the slides are here to help you follow along. And here we are back on the slides, and here we have the slides, the slide how to run a container. I will upload the slides, by the way, so that you have something for your reference that you can use after this class as well. So what do we see on this slide? We see the commands Popman pull, Popman run. Popman run can be used with different options, and we need to talk about detached and interactive TTY mode and stuff like that. So that was a very short visit to the slide. Let me get back to the demo environment so that we can talk a little bit about this stuff and how to use it. So we have just seen Popman pull, right? I don't have to do Popman pull anymore. We have also seen Popman run minus D. We have not yet seen Popman run minus IT. What is Popman run minus IT? Popman run minus IT is giving us an interactive terminal. Let's do something funny. I'm using Popman run Ubuntu. What do you think is going to happen? Well, first, it's complaining that in the Red Hat registries, it doesn't find any Ubuntu. That's not so very surprising. Then it did find an Ubuntu image in the Docker registry. So this is what's happening. We don't see anything. Now we type Docker PS. What do we see? Docker PS, sorry. I'm making this mistake a lot. And I'm sure if you have done containers before, you are going to make this mistake. So let's just follow the friendly suggestion that the software is making. The software is suggesting to install package Popman Docker to provide the command Docker. Yeah, let's do that. The idea is that you get Docker, and Docker is basically a symbolic link to Popman with the advantage that the next time by accident you type Docker instead of Popman, you see what you expect to see, which is what we see right here. This is equivalent to Popman PS, but we do not see the Ubuntu container that we just started. Why? Well, let's do Popman PS minus A. Popman PS minus A is showing all that we have recently been doing. And what do we see on the first line? We see that an image was found, docker.io Ubuntu latest. The command that it started was binbash. It was created 53 seconds ago. It exited 53 seconds ago. The big question is, why did that happen? Well, this is where you need to remember the part where I was explaining about system container images and application container images. If you run an application container image like Nginx, then it is typically just going to start the application image. And the application typically would be a daemon process, and as it is a daemon process, it will stay around. Like if you use systemd to start Nginx, for example. But this Ubuntu image is not an application container image. It is it's not a system image. It's an application image. I say it the wrong way around. It's not an application image, it's a system image. And this system image is configured to start a bash shell. And then, as a container is a fancy way of starting an application, after starting the bash shell, it's done. So that is why it comes up, and it immediately goes down again. And this is one thing that you really should be aware of when working with these system images. It's so confusing. That these system images are doing it this way. One way to work with that is to use Popman run minus IT for interactive terminal, minus IT Ubuntu. And what is that going to do? That is going to run the Ubuntu image again, and this time is providing me an interactive terminal. And this interactive terminal is exactly what I want to be looking at, because in the interactive terminal, we can explore a little bit more what the container is all about. First, let's use PSAUX. This is what we call a process namespace. If you know a little bit about the functioning of the Linux operating system, then you might be surprised about the fact that /bin/bash is using PID1. Normally PID1 is used by systemd. In this case, PID1 is not used by systemd. It's used by bin bash. That is because bin bash is the default application in Ubuntu. It's what we call the entry point application. It starts a bash shell, and it doesn't see anything else but the processes running within this process namespace. Now, in this process namespace, we have also seen PSAUX, which is the command that I've just typed. Now, how about ifconfig? Well, unfortunately, ifconfig IP is not found. Why is that not found? For the simple reason that a container is providing a mount namespace as well. And a mount namespace means that we have a very limited environment. We don't have full access to all of the utilities. So for that reason, some of the normal functionality does not work. Hey, let's have a look at cat on etc passwd. That's the user database. This is passwd. And maybe you recognize _apt, which is the apt user, and the apt user, it's definitely something that's not existing on a CentOS environment. Let me also show you cat on lsb release. Yeah, lsb release. That is where we can see which operating system this is. And we see this is Ubuntu 20.04. But the big magic, I'm using uname-r. What do we see in uname-r? Uname-r, for your information, is normally showing the kernel version that is being used. And we can see that the kernel is 4.18.0-193.EL8. What is EL8? EL8 is Enterprise Linux. Enterprise Linux means that this is your ordinary, Red Hat kernel. Not exactly, it's a CentOS kernel, but it definitely is not an Ubuntu kernel. Some of you might be familiar with Ubuntu, and you probably know that Ubuntu is already on the 5 kernel series. And if you're still not convinced, then I will tell you in a little bit. Let's use exit. What do you think is happening if I type exit? Well, let's do a Docker PS, and Docker PS again is Podman PS. I do this by mistake. Podman PS is showing that the Ubuntu container is gone. I have typed exit, and by typing exit, I have sent an exit to the PID1 within the container. So typing exit, if you are in such an interactive terminal shell kind of thing, it's not the smartest way. You need Control P, Control Q. Control P, Control Q is what you use to detach from a running container. So now I'm detached from the container. Now I'm using Docker PS, and Docker PS is showing that the Ubuntu container is still running. Oh, and if we use uname-r on top of the CentOS host operating system, what do we see? We see the exact same version of the kernel. So this is what we have seen from within the container. This is what we see from the container host. And why do we see this as the same kernel version? Well, this is just proving the point that I was previously making, that containers do not contain a kernel. Containers run on top of the kernel that is provided by the host operating system. Right, what else is interesting? Well, I think it's interesting to use psfax as well. Now, do notice that I am on the host operating system here. And on the host operating system, we can see this this process, this psfax command. And in the psfax command, somewhere in there, I should be finding my container. I look right here. Here we have Podman. So that is one thing to start with. And here we have, for example, you've been common an Nginx worker process. This is my Nginx container. The point that I want to make here is that containers from the host operating system are just visible as ordinary processes. That means that if you're in the host operating system and you would give a nice kill command, for example, that kill on 4300, that would be sudo ps, no, sudo kill minus 9 on 4300, is something that you can do on the host operating system to do nasty stuff on your containers. But apparently I've used kill on the wrong process. I'm having a little bit of a hard time finding back the exact PIDs for the containers. And I don't want to waste our time right now to find them here. Yeah, it's not very efficient. Bottom line is, look hard enough and you will find your containers running as processes on the host operating system. Right. What are we going to do next? Next, I am going back to the slides and tell you a little bit about stuff that we see in the slides. So this is kind of the commands that I just typed. We need to talk about managing container images a little bit. Again, one of the missions is to prepare you for the RHCSA stuff about containers. So I'm following the requirements that Red Hat has been posing for that. Maybe you want to give me 1 minute so that I'm going to share the course materials. Give me 1 minute, then I'm going to make sure that you get access to the slides I am using in just a little bit of time. There we go. It might very well be possible that in the course interface you go to the materials section, that you can already find the materials that I have just added. So please have a look and probably you can find the slides already. I do appreciate. Thank you, Hermano, for letting me know that it's there. Okay, that makes it a little bit easier for me. Then I can just say, hey, have a look at slide number whatever, and I don't have to swap between slides and demo interface that much anymore. Right, I'd like to continue for about 5 more minutes, then we do the first break of the day, and then we continue after the break. So let's talk about images. So the image is a read-only runnable instance of the container. Containers always start with an image. And the images come from a registry, and registries are specified in etc containers registries.conf. That's what we've just talked about. You can add your own registries in registries.search, and insecure registries are in registries.insecure, and you can use podman.info to find information about your images, and then you can search for images. If you want to follow along based on what we do on the slides, then I would say make sure you have the slide searching for images in front of you, and then I can go back to demo mode and show you in demo mode what we are doing with it. Right, let me start using Podman Info. Podman Info is giving a lot of information. And in the information, if you are patient enough, you will find the list of the container registries that you are currently using. There we go, registries, search. This is what we are using right now. Also interesting information about the rest of what is being used. For example, these container images, where are these container images stored? The container images are stored in, oh, you still see the slides only. Okay, let me fix that. I know that sometimes that's an issue with the interface that I need to disconnect again. Hermano, do you see? Yes, you see it now. Okay, good. So let me start from the top. I use Podman Info. Podman Info is giving information, and in the information you can see useful information about your containers with the list of registries, which is somewhere in there. There we go, registries. This is the registries configuration and other environmental configuration. Do notice that there is, for instance, a volume path. The volume path is in home student.local share container storage volumes. And that means that as we are using rootless containers here, the rootless containers are storing the container information in the user home directory. And that is really something to consider, because if you have like 100 different users who are all going to run containers on your server, do you really want to store these container images in 100 user directories? Probably not. And probably that is where you want to run root privileges, to pull your images and to store the images in the location where they will be fine. They will be findable for everybody. Right, that's not something that we need to worry about today. What we need to worry about is Podman Search. So if I'm going to use Podman Search Ubuntu, what do I get? Well, first I need to wait a little bit, and then I get a lot of results. Let me pipe that through WC. WC for word count, 26 lines in total. So we have 26 images that match the description Ubuntu. That is probably not what you want, and for that reason you might want to limit down a little bit. So if I use Podman Search Ubuntu with --- limit 5, then I get the top 5 results only. And if you see the top 5 results only, normally you will find the best images on the top of the list. Another filter that will definitely work is the filter. Filter --- filter is official, is true. So we have images that we call official images. Official images are created by a software vendor. And here you can see this is giving the official image only. Now you can see that for these images, we have a name of the index. We have the full name of the image. The full name of the image has the name of the registry as well. We have a little bit of description, and we have an appreciation in stars. Now, what is this appreciation in stars? This is the community appreciation for the image. So 11,424 community members seem to have liked this specific image. Now, you can even filter on the stars by applying another filter, but let me use --- no trunk to increase a little bit the readability. You can see right here, this is not readable. Ubuntu is Debian-based Linux operating sys. Here, at least we can read the entire line, and that might be convenient. Now, if you want an easier interface to search, because to be honest, I don't like this Podman Search too much, just go to the browser, and in the browser, try hub.docker.io for the Docker Hub. Wow, we are slow. Just wondering what is going on here. Let's not try hub.docker.io. I'm not that patient. How about access.redhat.com/containers? Yeah, that is working. So this is the Red Hat container catalog. And on this Red Hat container catalog, you can find container images. Container images that are provided for Red Hat environment. I like using this approach because if you take this this approach there, you see database and data management, and here you can see all the different containers with nice status information, and it is readable, and you can click it, and if you click on it, then you get a decent description, you get version information, you get security information. This is one of the advantages that Red Hat is giving you, by the way. Red Hat, as you know, you are paying for the software because of the services that Red Hat is adding to it, like verifying security, and they're doing that. Here we can see the packages. We can even see the Docker file. This is very interesting. Docker file is not really a topic in today's class, but a Docker file is how this container image was built. And this is giving you insight in the instructions that I use behind that. I hope that this this course today is going to be a start of a fantastic journey in the world of containers, and you will definitely come across Dockerfile sooner or later. And get this image. Well, this is giving information on how to get it. And you can see what you see right here. This is how you would get it in an OpenShift environment. The OC command that we have right here, this is OpenShift. Again, Red Hat wants to sell you OpenShift because they want to make money on you. But even if they are not going to sell you OpenShift, well, here you can see how to get it. So Popman Pool, shall we just copy this command and run it from a command line? So look at the shell interface, copy it from the shell interface, then you get the command back to your CLI. You do your paste and trying to pull, and once it is done, the container image should be available. To be honest, I have no idea what exactly I downloaded now, but this is basically how you work with images from the Red Hat website. On Docker, you have a similar interface. I don't know why I could not open the web page to Docker here. But hey, the Red Hat website is much more interesting. Do notice that you might have to provide your credentials before you can fully access all the stuff that we have on the Red Hat website. Right. At this point, I want to do a quick break. So here is what we are going to do. My breaks are 12 minutes, in case you think that is weird. I know it is weird, but I don't care. 10 minutes is not enough. 15 minutes is too long, so 12 minutes it is. I am starting the break timer so that you know when I'm expecting you back. That should be quarter past the hour, basically, quarter to the hour if you are in India. So enjoy your break, and I see you in 12 minutes. All right, everybody, my counter is done. So let's continue, talk a little bit more about containers. So what is next? Let me have a look at the slides for a little bit. We've done a slide searching for containers. Then there are some additional stuff. So you can inspect containers, and inspecting containers can be interesting. There are two commands that you can use to inspect your containers, and these are Scopio as well as Popman, where Popman is the command that you can use to inspect containers that are locally available, and Scopio is the command that you can use to inspect containers before you even pull them. And that can be interesting because, well, if you inspect your container before pulling it, you can investigate it and check if security-wise the container is giving you what you want. Changing back to the demo interface, you should be able to see the demo interface again. Just to make sure that you synchronize with what I'm doing, I am trying to indicate what you should be seeing so that you can verify and let me know if that's not the case. So I am going to start with Scopio inspect, followed by URL. The URL is docker:// registry.redhat.io/ub8/ub. In case you are surprised by the URL format is a Docker format, for the simple reason that Docker is the way how the image is created. So what do we see? We see a name, we see a repository tags. These tags, you can see there is tags for every specific subversion. You can see that it has create timestamp, Docker version name. It has a couple of labels as well. Labels are pretty important to manage container images, but not really for what we are doing here. And there we can see that there's an environment, and this is the environment path that we see. Hey, didn't we already have this thing locally? Podman images should show that. And yeah, there we go. Podman images is showing us that we have registry access.redhat.com. Let me copy that and let me use Podman inspect. So if we use Podman inspect on the same thing, and let's pipe it through less this time, then you can see that there's a little bit more information. One thing, for instance, we can see the command is set to bin bash. For some reason, Scopio Inspect was not able to show us what the command is set to. Podman Inspect does show us that. There is a little bit of information about it as well. And it has a size and a virtual disk size and the root FS and a little bit of history as well about the image. I think we should also try this on the other image. So Podman images once more. And this time I am doing it on my SQL. Is this what I want? No, this is not what I want. Sorry, let's start Podman search. Podman search. Minus minus filter stars. Is 5 MySQL. Oh, that's a lot of result, more than what I expected. And there I can see there is a lot of images. Okay, the MySQL from Docker.io, why not? So Podman pull MySQL. Is pulling it from the Docker.io environment. MySQL happens to be one of the bigger images, but fortunately I have decent internet connectivity. The last time I tried it over a 1 megabit line and it took like forever, but this is doable. Let me use Podman images. Because if we are going to inspect, we need to be specific. So, well, there we go. And Podman inspects on the Docker.io dot whatever. Pipe less. And what do we see? Well, we see environment. We see an entry point. So the entry point is a shell script, and the shell script apparently is going to run this command. The command is mysqld. And if you go a little bit later, do we see interesting stuff? A little bit of history and more history, and well, that is about it. Is this interesting? Well, in case you are into Docker files, it is interesting because you can see the entire build process in the Docker in the image. The reason why I need you to use Podman Inspect is because sometimes your images will not allow you to do whatever you want them to do. And then if you use Podman Inspect, then you get more information about what exactly the image is all about. Sometimes there's a fair amount of documentation in there as well, and that is convenient. Right, back to Podman images, because you can see that playing around for a little bit has already created quite some image stuff on my computer, especially this MySQL APB 2.2 gigabytes. Wow, df minus 8, how much space do I have? 5.8 gigabytes remaining. Bottom line here is that if you are going to play with this stuff on a system that doesn't have unlimited system resources, some point sooner or later you will run out of available memory, and that is why you want Podman RMI. I definitely don't need this this MySQL AP whatever, so let me copy that and let me clean up 2.2 gigabytes. That is that's useful enough. Right, there is some advanced image management as well. Let me go to the slides a little bit so that we can forward in the slides as well. And this advanced image management is about the Builder utility. Now, what is this Builder utility? Well, this Builder utility is a utility that allows you to build your own images. Builder is extremely cool, but fortunately for you, you do not have to know about it for the RHCSA exam. So I am going to skip on this complicated demo if you don't mind. Maybe if we have time, we can do it at the end of the of today's class. But for now, let's save the time and let's not do this Builder stuff. For those of you who know a little bit more about containers already, what is Builder all about? Well, Builder is simply about a replacement for what you can do to build your own container images. Because in the end, if you are an application developer, the new way of distributing access to your application is by providing container images, runnable container images. And Builder is how you build these images in a Red Hat environment. Oh, and just so you know, Podman can work with Dockerfiles as well. So if you have done this thing before, you know how to work with Dockerfile, continue and keep on using your Dockerfile. That still works as well. Right, let's talk about managing containers. So what do we need to know in order to manage containers? Well, you need to know how to manage container ports, how to manage environment variables, how to manage container state, how to run commands in a container. You need to know about root containers as well. So quite a couple of things are involved. So what do we see? Well, this is the first thing that we see, but instead of doing it from the slide, I will just run the commands here. So going back to my demo system, and in the demo system, I am going to use Podman run minus D minus P 8000 colon 80 Nginx. What is this doing? Well, this is running Nginx, but this time it is running Nginx in a way that it is exposed. So it's exposing port 8000 on localhost, and it's forwarding that to port 80 within the container. This is what you need in order to expose access to a non-root container. This is important to realize. If you are on a non-root container, non-root containers by default do not bind to any port. So by default, it runs a container, nobody can access it in whatever way. So if you want your container to be accessible, you need to be doing something. And the something in this case is a port mapping. Which is also known as port forwarding. So right here we have exposed port 8000 on the host, and that is forwarding to port 80 in the container. And if next we are going to use sudo firewall cmd dash dash add port is 8000/tcp, then we open it right now in the firewall. And then we need to do it again using minus minus permanent to make it persistent. And at this point, users should be able to access this container on host port 8000. So curl local host colon 8000 should give me welcome to Nginx. There we go. Just a quick tip, if you still need to do your RHCSA exam, on your RHCSA exam, obviously, the purpose is not just that you are going to expose a port on your container, but that you make your container accessible. So in your RHCSA exam, think about this very carefully, because just exposing it doesn't make it accessible from the outside. And that means that if you are going to see containers on RHCSA, related to your containers, there is firewall configuration, there is SE Linux configuration, there might be some Linux permissions to consider as well, and that is something that you should not forget on the RHCSA exam. So firewalling in this case. This was a container that is running without root privileges, and as it is running without root privileges, it can bind to a non-privileged host port only. Right, next thing that we need to talk about on the slides, let me get back to the slides, is managing environment variables. Now, what is the thing? The thing is that some containers require environment variables to run them. And if that is the case, sometimes the information is in Podman inspect. Sometimes the information is not in Podman inspect, and you need Podman logs to find out that the container needs additional information. And if the container requires environment variables, then you may have to run a command like the last command that you can see on the slide, which is podman run minus D for the detached mode, minus minus name mydb, minus E MySQL root password, minus E MySQL user, MySQL password, MySQL database, minus P for some port forwarding as well on MariaDB. Wow, that is a lot of information. Let me demonstrate to see if there is an easy way out of this. And when I say an easy way out of this, then I basically mean a way that makes it possible to do this stuff on the exam. So first, Podman search on MariaDB. Let me just do a less on that so that we can filter the results. And yeah, there we can see that there is a couple of Red Hat MariaDBs. Is there anything of these that I would like to use? I don't think so. So let's just run it. Podman run MariaDB. And there you can see, because I have not referred to any of these specifics that's available in one of the Red Hat registries, that I am getting access to the Docker one. Excuse me. Some information about the exam. If you are going to run containers on the exam, your exam environment does not typically have complete access to the entire internet. In your exam, you will have some local registries that will have been pre-configured. So it's unlikely to expect that you need to set up your own registries. The exam environment should be configured to go to your registries by default. What I wanted to show you here is if you run it, then this is what it's giving us. So it is trying to run the MariaDB application. I was not using minus D, and as I was not using minus D, it was not in detached mode, but it has written all the information to the current screen. And there we see the message database is uninitialized, and you need to specify one of MySQL root, MySQL allow empty password, MySQL random root password. Alternatively, Podman PS minus A first, because I need the exact name, and there I can see suspicious Vaughan. So I'm going to copy suspicious Vaughan, and I'm going to use Podman logs on suspicious Vaughan. In case you have missing information that was generated while running it, you can always access this information using Podman logs. The nice thing about Podman logs A container runs a primary application, okay? I'm trying to explain how these logs are working. The container runs a primary application. The primary application normally wants to dump its output on the standard out, but if you run it in detached mode, then it doesn't have a standard out. And for that reason, to make it possible for you to explore later on what this thing has been trying to do, there is a log status that will be stored on your container, even on your system, even for containers that are no longer running. So if you have missed the information, try Popman logs. You can also try Popman inspect. Let me do that one more time. So Popman images, oops, Popman images, there we go. And this is the one that I need. I previously done it on MySQL. MySQL is not MariaDB, so let me do Popman inspect on this MariaDB thing. Pipe that through less. And we should see if there is a usage line somewhere in there. Usage. No, there is no usage line. That's so disappointing. As I was mentioning before, sometimes you will find information about how to run this thing in the container image itself, but not always. Right. Once you have figured out how to run it, you can pass all these environment variables, and that would be Popman run minus d minus minus name. We have not seen minus minus name before. We have seen that containers are created with these random names. Not everybody likes these random names. So you might use minus minus name to specify a name for yourself. And then MySQL root password is password. And minus e, that is MySQL user is Bob. And minus e, MySQL password is password, and minus e MySQL database is books, minus p for some port forwarding 3306 to 3306, and we are doing this on MariaDB, and that should be doing it. And now my MariaDB container is running. Is that so? Podman PS should show us, and yeah, that appears to be so. So we can see that it is running. We have all the information about it. So Podman, Podman inspect on my DB. Does that also work? Do notice that I've just used Podman inspect on a container image. Now I'm running Popman inspect on a running container, and running Popman inspect on a running container is giving you lots of information about what it is doing. This is more information about the process environment, very detailed, telling you about mount points, about capabilities, about network settings. In which we can see the host port and the container port. That is interesting. There is one thing that you won't find in here, and that is the IP address. And oh, look at that. Here we have the environment, the complete environment that this container is using. I think Podman inspect on a running container is really a very, very convenient command to figure out what exactly the container is doing. I want to look at this. We even have information about the C groups. You know, C groups is all about resource limitations, providing access to specific resources. Here we don't have any resource limitations, but if you do, you can find that right here. Right. I think that is enough about Popman inspect and environment variables. Let's have a look at what is next on the slides, and that is about container state. This is a boring slide. It's Popman PS. We have seen Popman PS minus A. Podman PS by default does not show containers that are in a stopped state. If you want to see containers in a stopped state as well, you append minus A to that. Podman stop my container will stop container gracefully, sending a sick term. Do notice if that doesn't work after 10 seconds by default, it will get a sick kill anyway. If you don't want to wait for that, you can also use Podman kill my container. My opinion, I think you're an idiot if you're immediately trying to use Podman kill. Why would you want to do that? Because the only thing that you can get with it is the risk of getting damaged. Podman kill doesn't give the container one single opportunity to save files in a decent way. Podman stop will do that. Podman RM is removing a container, including all file modifications that are written to the container writable layer. We have not talked about the container writable layer yet. We will talk about that in a little bit. Podman restart my container. That's obvious, isn't it? I'm not going to run through all of these, but I am going to talk about running commands in a container. You know what I just figured out? I just figured out that you have an old version of the slides. Please allow me to fix that and make sure that you have the new version of the slides. New slides are cool, isn't it? I need 1 minute probably. Just making sure that this time I am sending you, yeah, this is the right version. I need to export the PDF and then I need to do my complicated things to make sure that the slides are uploaded to the platform. As I was telling you, about 1 minute, not very much more. The interface is not the most friendly, still navigating to find the file. Wrong directory, but almost here. And it is uploading right now. You know what, I'm not going to wait for that. Try it within 5 minutes or so. I'm going to use the new version of slides right now. And you will have it in 5 minutes or so. Oh, and this is the new version. Oh, it's already uploaded. That's fast enough. Good to know. Thanks, guys. Right, running commands. I will show you this running commands in a little bit. But what I want to do is root containers now that we are still looking at the slides. So by default, Podman runs non-root containers, okay? Non-root containers, as you know, cannot bind to a privileged port and they do not have an IP address. And the only way to access the application is port forwarding for the simple reason that the container does not have an IP address. And if you need a container that has an IP address, you need to run it as a root container. For example, sudo podman run minus d nginx. Root containers will only show if you use sudo podman ps. And after starting a root container on the host operating system, a bridge device is created that works like NAT to make sure that the root container can connect to the network. Now, this is something that I would like to demonstrate. Let me start with sudo IPA. And what do we see? We have four network interfaces. These are kind of the default network interfaces. You still see the slide. Let me unshare and let me try it again. Is this working better, Hermano? Good. Again, that's a bug in the interface, and I need your feedback in order to know that it didn't work out all right. Good. What we are looking about right now, even if we are running a couple of containers, IPA is only showing ENS33 and VRBR0 and VRBR0 NIC. These VRBR0, that has to do with virtualization. You can completely ignore them. They are not important at all. Now I am going to use, doing that right here, sudo podman run minus -d nginx. The interesting thing is that you can see that it's going to pull the image again. So it's not aware of the fact that the image is already there in a specific user environment. Now I'm using sudo podman ps, and sudo podman ps is showing that we have an nginx container that is running with the name epic chevy. Wow, what a name, epic something. Let's do sudo IPA again. Doesn't really need sudo, but what I wanted to show you is that right here we have two new network interfaces, CNI podman, and we have VETH whatever. So how does it work? Well, it works in a way that if you run a root container, the root container needs an IP address. It needs this IP address to be accessible in some way. And in order to make it accessible in some way, it's creating a virtualized bridge device. And the virtualized bridge device is a CNI podman that you can see right here. From within the container, in order to connect to the virtual bridge device, we see a representation on the host operating system with the name VETH whatever. This is a networking approach. It is very much like the networking approach in a virtualized environment. But the idea is that if I use my sudo podman ps again and my sudo podman inspect on epic, or I can't even do bash completion, so let's do epic Chevy Chef. So here we have Chevy Chef, and we scroll up a little bit, somewhere in there we are going to find an IP address. Look at that, IP address 10.88.0.2. There's one big difference between the non-root container and the root container. Now, why do non-root containers not have an IP address? Well, for the simple reason that in order to bind an IP address on your computer, you need root privileges. Simply not going to work without these root privileges. So that's an important difference between non-root containers and root containers. Non-root containers work by port forwarding only. So the port mapping is very important in order to access your non-root container. Root containers do get an IP address, do create this container network bridge thing. And also realize that there's a big difference between sudo podman ps, which is basically showing all the containers running in the root environment, and an ordinary podman ps, which is showing all the containers running in the current user environment. They are isolated environments. And now that we are in demo mode, we need to talk about running commands within a container. So let me do that from a non-root environment. And let me use podman exec on mydb. That is how you can run no matter which command within a container. uname minus r, for example, showing the current kernel version. It doesn't really matter which command you are running. It's about the fact how you run a command within a container. If you use Podman exec mydb, you don't attach to the container, you don't open an interactive terminal, you run a command and you see the standard output of the command. If you need to get more involved, then you can use Podman exec, Podman exec minus it mydb slash bin slash bash. That is trying to run a bash shell. And I say it's trying to run because this is only going to be successful if there is a bash shell available in the container. Well, in this case, fortunately, there is a bash shell available in the container. So Podman exec minus it is running it. So I'm in the container now and I can do my stuff. And I can do Podman ps, I can do ps aux, for example, to figure out which processes are running. Funny enough, the commands that I'm opening, that I'm running in the shell, are root commands. But these root commands are not root commands from the host operating system point of view. These are root commands from the container point of view. Right, if I'm going to type exit right now, do you think I'm going to close down the container? Well, let's try it. Exit and Podman PS, and look at that, we still have mydb. And why is that? Well, I was entering the bin bash shell and I was telling exit to the bin bash shell. Bin bash was a secondary command. It was not the primary command that was running within the container. Let's do next topic, and next topic, let's explore slides again. Next topic is about storage and containers. That is three slides only. We'll do that before the break, so that after the break we have the all the remaining time for managing containers as services. Right, what is this about? Well, this is about attaching storage to containers. What you need to know, storage, container storage is ephemeral. That's how we call it. Ephemeral is short-living. Short-living means that modifications in a container are written to the container writable layer. This container writable layer stays around for the container lifetime. That means that if you are going to start whatever container, you make a configuration in the container, it writes to the writable layer, you stop the container, you start it again, it has access to these modifications. Because in a standalone situation, you will access the same writable layer. But the problems arise if you are going to try to orchestrate your container. If you orchestrate your container, then you may have different instances of the same application. Your application may not consist of one container, it may consist of three containers with a load balancer in front of it. If you orchestrate your container, the container that today is running on node 1 in your cluster, tomorrow may be running in node 2 of your cluster. And what does that mean? Well, that means that this writable layer is a very weak method of providing access to files within the container. I mean, if today my container is running on node 1, today I make my modifications, the writable layer is stored on node 1. Tomorrow, for some orchestration reasons, I am starting the same container from node 2, I have lost access to all that is stored in the writable layer. And that is why this writable layer is not very successful. And you should always make sure that you keep your files externally. Now, at the day that you are going to learn how to work with Kubernetes and with OpenShift, you will learn in much detail how you can do this in a cloud compatible way to make sure that the storage is completely decoupled from the container and the container is just attaching to your storage that is somewhere. Today, we need to learn how to work with external storage, persistent storage, that makes sure that at least the files are kept externally from the container. And the secret behind this external storage is the bind mount. A bind mount is a mount offered directly on the host operating system inside the container operating system. So the bind mount connects a directory inside the container to a directory on the host. So how does that work? Well, you need to prepare host storage. But hey, if you are going to prepare host storage, you need to ensure that the user account that is used in the container has access to the host directory and set the SELinux context type to container file T. Yes, dear everybody, if you are going to do your RHCSA exam or even without, if you are going to run this stuff on Red Hat Enterprise Linux or on CentOS, you need to consider SELinux. SELinux is about security context labels, and the security context label is mandatory to tell SELinux that containers can access this directory. So you either are going to set the security context label manually using SEManageFContext, or you are going to do it automatically. But the automatic part is only going to work if the container user is owner of the host directory. Then you can use popman run minus d minus v webfiles colon slash webfiles colon uppercase z nginx. Using SELinux is essential, and without it, all root containers would have full access to the host operating system. So this is very important. I'm going to run this command, we can see on the slide here, and I'm going to run it in a way that is going to force us a little bit to think about what exactly it is that we are doing. So let me create mkdir, sudo mkdir slash webfiles, okay? And now let me run popman. Popman run minus D. I shared access to my demo machine. You should be seeing my demo machine now. So popman run minus D. Then we are using minus V. Minus V is a new option that we've got here. And the minus V is making the bind mount. So this is what you need to configure your storage. And I'm configuring slash webfiles colon slash webfiles. Uppercase Z nginx. And what do we get? We get an error relabel field, slash web files operation not permitted. What is this error? This error is an SELinux error. I'm going to open a root shell for a little bit because I want to see what's happening behind the scenes in SELinux. But just the error message relabel is an SELinux thing. So if we open the root shell and we do grep avc on var log audit.log, oh, we don't see anything that has been logged. That's disappointing. I was hoping to see something that had been logged. How about grep se alert in var log messages? Well, I don't think we see anything either because se alert is working based on the logs in the audit log. So this didn't make it up to SELinux, so we cannot use the default SELinux tools in order to troubleshoot. That is a little bit disappointing. Then we need to rely upon our understanding. If I'm using ls minus uppercase zd on slash web files, then what do we see? We see the SELinux context on the web files directory. Now, what did the slide say? The slide says that if the container user is owner of the host directory, you can use minus uppercase Z. That would be the easy option. So the easy option would be to use chown student on slash web files. There is also a not so easy option, and that would be semanagef context container file T on slash web files with a weird regular expression, and that is I am forgetting my minus a and minus t. And that's the other way of doing it. If you manually set the context this way, then don't forget that you need restore con minus r v on slash web files to apply. At this point, if I get back to my user shell and I'm running my Podman run again, then you can see that it is working. Notice that as I had manually set the context already, it was not really necessary anymore to use uppercase minus Z. Everybody, I need you to realize that I'm mixing two approaches here. One approach is the approach where we are using the uppercase Z option to automatically set the context, which is only working if the user is owner of the directory. That is one approach. If you use that approach, then you don't have to use the approach where you are manually running SEManage as well as restore con. I know that some of you are already at an RHCSA level. If you are already at an RHCSA level, then SEManage fcontext restore con is easy. I know some of you are far away from an RHCSA level and you have no clue what SE Linux is all about. If you have no clue what SE Linux is all about, just remember, before you are going to connect to external storage, you create the directory, then you make sure the user who runs the container is owner of the directory, and then you just use, no, not this one, you just use Podman run minus V with the directory mapping with the minus with the uppercase Z to automatically set the SE Linux context. I hope that is clear. If not, feel free to ask. There's one issue though. The issue is that it's not an issue. The container runs as this user and the user is owner, so the user has the right permissions in the directory. I'm going to do one more demo about exactly the same thing, just so that you have seen two approaches. This time we are going to run a database, so I'm using sudo mkdir db files. Next I'm using sudo chmod o plus w on slash db files. This is the approach where we make sure that the other's entity has the right permissions. So we are not changing the actual user who is owner. As we are not changing the actual user who is owner, we really need to make sure that we run the SEManage command. So sudo SEManage f context minus a minus t container file t on slash db files. With a regular expression that refers to everything that might exist below db files. Next, sudo restore con minus r v on slash db files to make sure that the SE Linux context relabeling has happened. And now we can use Podman run minus d minus minus name, let's call it bookdb, minus v slash db files colon slash var lib mysql colon z. Well, the colon z is not really required because I already did it manually. Minus e mysql user is Bob. Minus e mysql password. MySQL password is password, minus E, MySQL database is books, minus E, MySQL root password is password on MariaDB. And, oh, that is funny, relabel failed, db files operation not permitted. Does that make sense? Yes, because the current user, student, is trying to relabel. That's not permitted because this user is not owner. So we need to do it without. And now we are getting error creating container storage. Container bookdb is already in use. What does that mean? Well, my first failing attempt has resulted in a running container already. So we need a little bit of cleanup. Popman PS minus A. There we can see bookdb is created. So Popman kill bookdb. Oh, is not running. That is good. So Popman rm bookdb. We need to remove it. And just checking, I don't see it anywhere else anymore. So as it is no longer there, now I can start it. And now the bookdb container is running. Next, I'm using Popman exec minus it bookdb bin bash. I want to open a bash shell. And shoot, container cannot exec into container that is not running. Container state improper. That is unexpected. So Popman PS, is it showing us bookdb? I don't see bookdb. Failing demo. I wasn't hoping to see a failing demo. I might be troubleshooting this later. I'm not going to do that right now. I know that some of you like troubleshooting a lot. But I also know that this SE Linux stuff is complicated enough, and I would rather do the troubleshooting offline so that I am just going to tell you what is wrong instead of showing you a lot of information that might only confuse you. And that means that we are going to do a break now. So like before, 12 minute break. See you in 12 minutes. And after the break, we will continue and talk about managing containers as services. See you in 12. I will go on mute this time because I'm staying behind my computer, but see you in 12 minutes. And hello again, everybody. I am back and we are going to continue. So what did we have? We had this container that didn't want to start, right? So let me refresh your mind. Docker PS minus A is showing us that we have a bookdb. Bookdb exited 13 minutes ago. We took the wrong approach. I was going into the direction of SE Linux. SE Linux is not where you should be starting. If you have a container that is doing unexpected things, then what you should be doing is Popman logs. So Popman logs on bookdb is telling us what? It's telling us changing ownership of var lib MySQL operation not permitted. Aha. So what is it trying to do? It's trying to change ownership. That's not going to work. Now, there are two potential reasons why it's trying to do that. That might be because of the colon uppercase Z, but we don't have the colon uppercase Z anymore. Hence, the only valid conclusion is that var lib MySQL, MariaDB wants to change the ownership on var lib MySQL. So just having write permissions is not enough. It needs to change ownership. That's not going to work because the directory that it is really going to change is slash db files. And slash db files on the host operating system. To do an ls minus ld on that one, then we see that it's owned by root. That's not going to work. So we need sudo chown student on slash db files. Then we can try it again. So let's try it again. And okay, container name bookdb is already in use. I need Popman rm on bookdb. That's something that I often do wrong. A failing container stays around, and if you're trying to start it again, then the failing container is preventing from doing the same thing. So now I've removed it, and now I can see if I can run it again. There we go. And now Popman PS is showing us, still not showing us the bookdb. I was so hoping that this is making a difference, but BookDB still exited 14 seconds ago. Podman logs on BookDB. And there we go. And this is surprising. Changing ownership of varlib MySQL operation not permitted. To be honest, I'm not sure why we are getting the operation not permitted this time, because it is owned by student. Student is the one who runs the container. Should be doable. Hey, everybody, unexpected troubleshooting. I will give it 3 minutes max, okay? Podman RM, book DB, once more. So let's try to understand. LS minus L Z D on, what was the name? Varlib MySQL. No, the name was DB files. And we can see DB files is now owned by student. That's good. We have container fealty. That's good as well. To be honest, I have one additional thing that I can think of, and that is minus uppercase Z, not minus, colon uppercase Z, to take care of the SE Linux whatever. Let's get back to the logs and changing ownership. Everybody, I'm not sure what's happening. And I think that I should be continuing, because I need to investigate that. I was hoping, well, I was thinking, oh, changing ownership, that's because of the fact that I don't have right ownership on the parent directory. For that reason, changing ownership is not not permitted. But I don't really see why it is still giving this. I can give one more attempt. Sudo grep avc on var log audit audit.log. That is the grep for SE Linux related messages. And maybe SE Linux has logged something that does make sense. The only thing I can see is that it has logged the Debus daemon. So I don't think we should continue with this one. I am going to continue with the next topic, which is pretty important as well. That's managing containers as services. And I'm just just wondering what little detail did I change in this demo to have it not work this time. Huh. Frustrating. Okay, let's talk about containers as services. So what is this thing? This is something completely different that you absolutely need to know about for your RHCSA exam as well. The thing is that you automatically might want to start containers in a standalone situation. If you want to do that, you need to create systemd user unit files for rootless containers, and you need to manage them with systemctl. Automatically starting containers is the default if you are using orchestration through Kubernetes or OpenShift. If you're not using orchestration, then you need to find a different solution. And this solution is to start the container as a systemd service. So how does that work? Well, systemd user services are used. And these are used to start a specific service when a user session is opened and closed, and closed when the user session is stopped. In order to do that, your user needs sufficient privileges to enable services. And in order to have that work, you have to use logincTL. LogincTL is login control. That's the systemd session manager. And in the systemd session manager, you need to make sure that you use enable linger for the user for who you want to do this. Let's not do that now. Let's just start with the overview, and then we will I will walk you through the demo. Right. Next, you can manage containers using systemd services. How do we do that? Well, you do that by using Podman, and Podman generates a user systemd file for an existing container, and this file will be generated in the current directory. So the command that we are going to run is podman generate systemd minus minus name my web minus minus files. And to have systemd create a container when the server starts and delete it again when the server stops, you can add minus minus new as well. And to generate a service file for a root container, you should do it from etc systemd system as the current directory. So notice that we have two different approaches. Podman generate systemd is generic, the generic way that generates a systemd unit file. The systemd unit allows the container to be automatically started, and that can be in a user context, that can be in a root context. If it's in a root context, then the unit file needs to be an etc systemd system. That's the idea. Now, how do we create these user files? Well, if you do it from a user context, then the file needs to be in .config systemd user. And you can manage them using systemctl minus minus user. So systemctl minus minus user, daemon reload, systemctl minus minus, minus user, enable myapp.service, and systemctl minus minus user, start myapp.service. Systemctl user commands only work when logging in on a console or SSH. Do notice that this does not work in sudo or su sessions. That's an important limitation because everybody is thinking that sudo and su is providing exactly the same, but it is not. So let's see if we can configure all of this. In order to show you if we can configure all of this, this is what I want to do. In my video course, this slide deck comes from my video course. In my video course, I have labs. And here is the lab. The lab is about running MariaDB. And run MariaDB, but run it as a rootless container and generate a systemd user file that allows us to automatically start it with systemd. Here is the lab solution. This lab solution is what should do it. And I might have overlooked something because, hey, this is recently developed contents, but let's give it a try. The interesting fact here is that we are going to run my MariaDB again. And we are going to check and see if we can get my MariaDB up and running this time by taking a slightly different approach. So what I'm going to do is on the slides, I will show you all the steps from the environment that I am in. So I am showing the demo system right now. In the demo system, I am a student. That's exactly who I need to be. Next, I'm using Podman pool. Podman pool Nginx? No, Podman pool MariaDB. Add some copy-paste errors on the slides. That can happen. We need to work on the MariaDB. Good. So next, I need to create, I need to use sudo mkdir slash opt slash MariaDB to create the opt MariaDB directory. There we go. Next, I need chown student on slash opt slash MariaDB. Let's do that with sudo as well. To make sure that ownership is set correctly. Now the big question, Podman run. This is what was failing in the other one, right? So let's see how it works out this time. Podman run minus D minus minus name my MariaDB. Minus V. Minus V is for this this storage allocation. So minus V slash opt slash MariaDB. That's what we are going to use on the host OS. Var lib MariaDB, colon uppercase Z, minus E, MySQL, root password, is password, and minus E, minus E, that is MySQL database, is my DB. I think we already have my DB. Let's make that your DB. And we do that for MariaDB. There we go. Boltman, PS. And what do we see? We see that I've done something that is redundant. What was I doing? Not sure anymore. But here we can see the command that I've run. Oh yeah, now I can see what I've done. The MySQL database name is your DB. So we run the MariaDB image. We run it with the name MyMariaDB, and we see that this time it was running successfully. That's good to find out, by the way, that the uppercase Z option with the owner that is that has been set before we got started, the owner on the root mounted directory, seems to be more stable than the manual approach of using SE-manage fe-context to take care of the SE Linux stuff before. I have my running container at this time, right? So that is what we are going to use. In order to do that, I'm going to use sudo login ctl enable linger on student. Next, I'm using sudo login ctl show or whatever. Is it status? Probably. Okay, then it is --- help. And it is user status. I want user status. But before doing that, hang on. I need to get out of here. I need to log out because I just changed a setting for a user that is currently logged in. I don't believe that it's going to be successful. So I am logging out and logging in as that user again, just to make sure that this linger option is effective for the user. There we go, back to the terminal, and in the terminal I am going to type sudo login ctl show user student. That's command that I need. And in there we have, there we go, we have linger is yes. So far so good. And that means that we can continue, and in order to continue I am going to the .config directory. .config directory is a relatively new directory, and in this relatively new directory user environment can be stored. If we want to do the systemd stuff, we need to make sure that in this directory we have a subdirectory systemd user. And then I am going to this systemd user subdirectory, and in there I'm going to use popman generate systemd --- name my db --- files. And what do we see? We see that the systemd unit file has been generated, and the systemd unit file is container-mydb. The unit file by default gets a name, which is composed as container, that's automatically prepended, hyphen name of the container dot service. So who's the owner of that file? That would be me. That's what I'm expecting, because it's a systemd unit file, right? A unit file that is used in the user context. I'm going to use vim on this file. Just to fix one little issue, it is showing me one that is multi-user target. Multi-user target does not exist in the user context, and if you want it to work, you need to change that to wanted by is default target. That's a little bug that I think occurs in CentOS 8.2, but not in Red Hat, but I'm not entirely sure yet. But if you change wanted by to default.target, then it should be working. Interesting to see what exactly is this systemd unit file doing. Well, that is easy enough. We can see that the systemd unit file has an exec start, and the exec start is just running the popman command as popman start mydb, and the exec stop, popman stop mydb in the kill mode and everything. Well, this is how it should be working out. So now that I have applied my middle my little change, I can use systemctl systemctl minus minus user daemon reload. This is just an insurance that systemd is completely up to date about the change that has just been applied. Now that I have updated the configuration file to systemd, I can use systemctl minus minus user enable container mydb.service. So that has created a symbolic link. Let's analyze the symbolic link, and we can see the it created symbolic link. In systemd, the name is default.target.once, and that's going to container mydb service. And that means that at the moment we get into the default systemd target, this is going to be good. Next, systemctl status on container dash mydb.service. We are forgetting the minus minus user. That's not smart. There you can see that container mydb service is loaded and it is enabled as well. And that means that at this point, the container is enabled as a systemd service. There's only one way to figure out: sudo reboot. And there we go. And after the reboot, I expected the container to be started automatically. And that's what we are waiting for right now. So back to the terminal. And in order to verify, popman ps. And look at that, popman ps. MariaDB latest has been started, and that's all basically. Right, with that, a little bit earlier than expected, but I am at the end of the program, and I can spend a little bit more time if you have specific questions. If not, I'm going to wrap it up. What we are going to do, I am showing you the sample exam. I even have a sample exam question. Everybody, this is what I want you to do, and I'm not going to walk you through it, but this is how you are going to prepare for the RHCSA exam. On the slide that's on the top right now, you can see an assignment that can be very much like the assignment that you are going to see on the on the exam. Running containers, and I would advise you try that for yourself by the time you are preparing for the exam. After trying it for yourself, there's a solution on the next slide. It's basically the steps that we've walked through for the MariaDB container in my previous demo. I want you to do that for yourself, and then you should be good. Right, let's do questions. Hermano, you have a question. Hermano, I'm listening. Please ask. Well, you type your question, Hermano. I am going to generate a paste bin. That gives you a little bit of time. Help. Trying to generate my paste bin. Hermano, just to be sure, I expect you to be typing your question, okay? Does that work for you? And everybody, if you have never encountered any PasteBin before, PasteBin is awesome. There you go. I like to provide PasteBin as an additional resource to people who have attended my class. You can see the link in the PasteBin in the chat. That's my command history. And that allows you to easily find everything that we've done in this class. It's unfiltered, so it also includes any of the errors. So Hermano is asking, I've seen recently an update to Web Console, and now it offers Podman management. I have not seen it, I have not tried it. And that is, Hermano, because I am not a big fan of this this Web Console, to be honest. My experience throughout Hermano is that Web Console is trying to provide us with an easy interface to get things done. But especially if you look at it from an R8 CSA exam level perspective, it's always lacking features. So it might be a decent interface, and I'll definitely have a look at it one day sooner or later. But if you are here, Hermano, because you are preparing for the exam, then I would say be very careful with it, because most likely you'll be lacking stuff. Is there any other questions, everybody? I can see half of the audience has left already. So you know what? I think that's a sign, and that probably means no more questions. So everybody, I hope this was a useful way to spend your Tuesday afternoon. So I'm going to call it today. Thank you very much for attending today's session. It has been my pleasure teaching you, and I hope you learned a lot. So everybody, thank you very much once more, and I hope to see you soon in my next session. In case you are interested, and I think Hermano already registered, and some of the guys from the Living Open Source community as well, next session is October 29th. It's about Bash Shell scripting. I hope to see you there, and that's all for today. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a nice rest of the day, and bye-bye.